Man, recording is in progress here. Taly, how are you?
Good, how are you?
Good. I was thinking about our previous conversation, which we had a while back, I think.
Yeah, it's like a
And
month ago.
it was like a month ago. Where does time go? I have no clue where time goes.
Don't
And okay, who referred you to me? Somebody referred you to me, I'm pretty sure.
Steph Gordon, who I
Stephanie
actually met
Gordon.
at a food fair, so totally random and really beautiful connection.
That is pretty random, actually.
Yeah.
And I was like, man, I haven't heard from Stephanie in a long time. Actually, her episode was one of my first 50. It was in like the
Oh my
first batch of
goodness.
50, I think. But it was really cool. And every once in a while, she sends me somebody.
Yeah. Well, I'm
So,
glad she sent me to you.
yes, thank you so much. So, I mean, we're here to talk a little bit about your dating app, which I'm sure is a lot of work. So, let's get the background on why you decided to do this.
Yeah, so a few years ago, I ate at a blackout restaurant and had the chance to get to know total strangers in complete darkness, having no idea what they looked like. And I had a really beautiful conversation with them. And when the dinner ended and I saw them for the first time outside the restaurant, I realized that had I seen them beforehand, I would have assumed that we wouldn't have had anything in common just based on what they looked like, what I looked like. And I would have missed out on that connection and it would have really been a shame. And it sparked the thought, would people be more open to meeting and getting to know one another if they didn't know what the other people looked like first? And so Blink was born. This isn't to say love is blind. So we do incorporate physical attraction into the process, but we really rely on relationship psychology and trying to help people make deeper connections.
It's really interesting. I was thinking of Love is Blind, honestly. That's like
Is
totally what I was
exactly
thinking,
right.
right? That show, by the way, I liked the show, was pretty good. I thought not so much into the new episodes. It's like the show was aware of itself now and it feels too staged now,
Yeah.
but
But hey, it worked for two couples and they're
it
still
did work.
married
It did
despite the
work.
staged episodes later.
True. So tell me a little bit more about the whole not seeing the other person. Why do you think this is a different direction that you think is positive than the normal seeing each other, you know?
So I think thinking about the dating population and folks who are looking for a relationship, 50% of people are looking for something that is committed, and they're really struggling on traditional dating apps, which put looks first because it's really hard to know if you're going to be compatible with someone for a long-term partnership based on that. For the other 50% who are looking for something more casual, just looking to have a good time, that dating apps are working wonderfully. But there are like 79% of still single dating app users are deleting dating apps because they're
Whoa.
not enjoying the experience. And so there's a gap there. There's something missing. And we want to give people the chance who are looking for that committed relationship, the chance to focus on what matters, which is, do I connect with this person? Am I, able to have a conversation with them? Do I want to continue the conversation with them instead of just choosing based on, images and a profile, which statistically, those decisions based on profiles and photos are being made in less than 1 second, usually on attractiveness and race. So really just trying to give folks a different way to connect and meet one another because it's not working for everyone.
You said 79%.
Of still single folks. Yeah.
What's the underlying mechanism behind that? Is it the things that you just said, or what's the deeper issue there?
There are all sorts of reasons folks are deleting their dating apps. And some of those for the 79% are, not feeling safe, not enjoying the experience, and not feeling like it's really meeting the needs that they are looking for. But those folks are still single. They're just not finding what they're wanting on these apps that are meant to help them not be single anymore.
Yeah. I mean, is there what's the inherently maybe difficult thing about most versions of dating apps? Is it just too many options? Is it
I think
just
that's
it's
the
like
one.
a jukebox type of thing? Like,
It
what's
is.
the
It
deal?
reduces people to baseball cards. And again, if you're looking for a long-term relationship, a baseball card is not going to help. And like studies have shown that attractiveness and that initial chemistry actually isn't a great determinant of whether or not the long-term relationship will succeed. And so, it's what you said. There are too many options. People have this bigger, better, next ideology, like thought, like, oh, if I just keep swiping, I'm going to find the one person. But you're looking at a snapshot. You're looking at a curated profile that somebody might have spent hours on, had their friends help with. You're looking at photos that could be really old or totally inaccurate or edited. And it's just not, really helping people again who are looking for that long-term commitment find their person.
You think that most people on dating apps are looking for long-term relationships, or is it more casual?
It's 50-50. It's still, yeah, it's a large number of people. I forget the exact number, but it's in the millions. So that 50% is still pretty significant.
Right. Huh. That's really interesting. I wouldn't have guessed that. I mean, I guess I wouldn't know too much about it, honestly.
But it's a surprising number.
I think it is a surprising number. And I think to myself, what is the future of dating with something like this? And what are you, or what stage of development, or where are you at with your current deal with Blink?
So we did a proof of concept podcast, which we just wrapped season one, and we got amazing feedback from our daters. Yeah. We did that while we were developing the app. So we completed that, and we're looking to start season two. So that's one portion of the work that we're doing right now to continue promoting the app and help people experience Blink. In the meantime, we've been working on the app, and the app is actually almost ready for beta.
Okay.
And that'll be released, we're hoping, this month. We had a little hiccup with the app store where they wanted us to make our reporting function more robust. So now that that's done, we're going to resubmit it, and hopefully they don't raise any other flags that we need to address. Yeah. So we're really hoping that this month will be released in Los Angeles for a beta, and then we can do a broader release before the end of the year, and hopefully expand then to New York, which is our next target market.
I mean, it's probably the right target markets, right? I mean,
cities,
people, a lot of single people, probably.
Mm-hmm.
What are the things that you have been maybe most surprised about in doing this and starting this whole thing?
You know, I think the thing that surprised me most was when we did the podcast, I thought some people wouldn't like it. I thought, you know, we're probably going to get a mixed bag, but every single one of the people who participated said that they would do it again. And that was really validating. And so, you know, I thought, I was concerned, would people be interested in this idea of getting to know someone without having any idea what they looked like beforehand? Because people are so attached to the photos, and, you know, the person has to be 6 foot, whatever, you know, they're attached to these physical requirements. And we didn't have that experience when we were talking to people. That isn't to say that, you know, people don't feel that way. I think it's just that the people that we attract are really interested in the idea and really committed to finding their person. And so I think the market that we're targeting, the marketing that will come in, it's sort of self-selecting. And so that was a pleasant surprise.
So take me through, like, if let's say I was a user, which I wouldn't be, but let's say I was a user and I'm a single person, I'm going to do Blink. How does it work? Like, how is it different from the other dating apps that are out there?
So the sign-up process takes about a minute, which is very different from other apps where you have to go through all sorts of questions. You're putting in your name, your sexuality, your age, your, you know, interests, and very few lifestyle choices like smoking, drinking, politics. And then you upload a single photo, one photo. And once you do that, you put in your availability, and then we schedule you for your 10-minute Blink dates, which are the audio-only dates, based on the availability and the parameters you put in and your interests. And once we schedule you for that, you go on your date. You have no idea what the person looks like. All you know is their name. And if the date goes well, then you move on to what we call the glances, which is where you see three anonymized photos. That's where that one photo comes in, one of which belongs to the person you spoke with, and you don't know which. And this removes some of the rejection component. If it doesn't work out, you don't know if it was based on the photo, if it was based on the conversation, if it was them, if it was you. And it also goes back to this relationship psychology idea of we become more attracted to people based on whether or not we feel a connection with them. So you might have said no to one person's photo, but if you had a really beautiful conversation with them, you might say yes. And so that's what the experience looks like. And if there's mutual positive feedback on both the date and the glance, then folks match and can continue chatting in the app until they're ready to take it offline. And then go from there.
Interesting. So the scheduling part, is that different from other apps, dating apps? I mean, it sounds different. I've interviewed a lot of dating app creators and stuff, and that doesn't seem to be a part of what they're doing.
I think it is different. There are other audio voice first apps out there, and a lot of them rely on kind of voice clips where people will attach a voice clip to their profile, or you go to someone's profile and you can see a little bit of information about them. And, you know, it's still sort of a curated experience. We don't have that at all. It's really about you know, putting in your time. It's sort of like a virtual speed dating through an app. Yeah. So it's bringing that experience into your phone. And so it is different because we don't, again, want this kind of dating to be this curated thing, because a voice note, again, you can record that over and over and over again until you get your tone right, the exact wording. And that isn't representative of what your conversational style really is. And so we really want people to get back to dating when we are thinking about online dating and what we're offering people.
Do you feel like this may be good timing too with what's going on in the world and the pandemic and stuff, and people can't see, haven't been able to see each other as much, a lot more now? Does the timing feel more right for something like this, you feel like?
It does. And I think COVID was one piece of that puzzle. I think people now think about dating very differently, and people have embraced virtual dating because it's made it feel safer and more efficient. You're not spending an hour getting ready and an hour taking the subway to get to a date. You can just, you know, hop on your phone. But I think there are a few other things that have really worked in our favor. I think Love is Blind was a really great, you know, show. It came out last year, I think February. So I think people have really kind of embraced this idea of getting to know people without visuals, and they think it's really cool. I think also there's been kind of a wave for audio specifically. I think, you know, Clubhouse was really big. I think people like the ability to focus on what people are saying instead of worrying about, oh, is my hair in the right place? or like, I'm being recorded. So am I looking at the camera? Am I looking at myself? Right. There's like a Zoom fatigue component. So audio has really experienced a rebirth. And so I think a lot of different factors have really made this a really wonderful moment to introduce this app to the world.
It's funny, like when I had video and audio, I started doing that a while back. And people were like, well, please let me know ahead of time, because, you know, I want to, how I look. And I'm like, ah, okay, whatever, you know, like, what's the background I'm using?
Yep.
And so like a whole deal was when I just had, it was funny, when I just had the podcast and it was just audio, it's actually a very strange yet fulfilling experience to like not see the person and just hear their voice.
Yep.
You know, you have to wait on the pauses and be really diligent about listening to what someone says and not
it lets you really focus on it. Yeah, you're not there's nothing popping up on your screen, you're not looking at like the fly on the wall behind them. It really lets you focus on the conversation and really listening to it.
So how has this been, let's relate this to your personal life if we can, and your dating experiences, let's, if that's okay, like how has this been connected to your dating life?
So I fear I might have to disappoint you a little that I am partnered, and I actually did not meet my partner on a dating app. And so I sort of escaped some of the woes of modern dating. But thankfully, my co-founder, she has experienced the woes of online dating, and she met her partner on a dating app. And so she really brings that personal experience into the company and kind of what we're building.
Yeah. You know, it's interesting. I met my wife on Match.com back in 2003. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And I mean, that was like the dark ages of dating.
It was like this new thing nobody talked about.
And it was like, there was like a stigma about it, because I remember like, I was so like afraid of people knowing I was on it, because it was like, everybody's meeting each other in person at that time.
Right.
So it was like super like infancy of this version. And which is kind of correlated to this. My my wife would not send me a picture of her at all. She was like,
I love her.
I don't want to do that. I want you to just like know me. And so we talked for probably 3 weeks. I had no clue what she looked like. Zero.
That makes me so happy.
I know. It works. I'm telling you. And we met for the first time at the Baltimore Inner Harbor.
Yeah.
And I still had no clue what she looked like. So every person is like walking. This woman, I had no clue, was so like, she just came up to me and she's like, I'm Michelle. And I was like, Lynn, again, I had zero idea, but I already really liked her a lot. So it almost
did she look like what you expected?
No.
If I may ask. No.
Not at all. But that didn't, I mean, she looked wonderful to me, but I just, it's almost like it didn't matter. It almost didn't matter. And I feel like that's kind of what you're trying to get at with this.
Yeah, absolutely. And it's hard because, you know, you had multiple weeks to get to know her. So I think that really, again, you're really building that psychological connection. And that really goes back into like, someone becomes beautiful to you as you get to know them and, you know, fall in love with them. But what's happening now with modern dating is you don't even get a chance to get to that point when you're swiping left immediately. And so we're giving people a little bit of a version of what you got, but it's yeah. much more condensed. We are hoping to expand kind of the experience down the line, but we're definitely going for what you have with yeah. your wife. It seems like it's been since 2003. So it seems like it's going strong.
Yeah. We've been married almost 18 years. So,
wow.
Been pretty good, awesome. I would say. So we had kind of the archaic ages of dating, right? We're in like the plague years. We're like, and we're kind of, I don't even know what happened in the middle of that, but all of a sudden all these things started popping up, Tinder, Grindr, all this stuff, these hookup things. And now I'm starting to see, we talked about Zach Schlein with filter off. And now we have Blink. Where is all this headed in your mind?
I think there are going to be a few categories of dating apps. I think there are going to be the traditional swipe-based one. I think this already exists, but I think it'll solidify. I think there will be super niche ones. Like there are ones for people who like beards, for people who love cats, who like have very particular lifestyles.
Hold on. Are you serious? Are you serious?
Oh yeah. I don't remember what it's called, but I can send it to you afterwards.
Beard dating app was like, we like stouts.
Beard.
I was like, is it really?
Facial hair.
Okay, hold on. That's even weirder to me. I almost didn't get the beard thing. Beard?
Yeah. I'll have to look it up after and send you the name. But I can only imagine that there's probably a beer one as well. So who knows? So I think there's going to be like a whole grouping of all these super niche apps. And then there's going to be the personality first apps, which include, you know, filter off and some of these others, including ourselves, which are really helping people who want those committed relationships.
Yeah, so you see this as kind of becoming very specific over time. Okay. So this is like maybe for this person as a cat, we're all cat people. Like this is for dogs. Dogs are for lovers.
Dogs. There's a dog one. I also forget its name off the top of my head, but I'm telling you, there are, I think, over 8,000 dating apps. There's so many. And you'd think that meant that there wasn't room for more, but most people are using 4 to 5 apps at any given time. So go ahead.
But what's the reasoning behind that? Like to increase your odds, your chances? I mean,
I think it's either to increase their odds or it's not working, or they just, you know, go to different places for different things, depending on their mood. If they're looking for, you know, today I'm in the mood for a video chat because I'm feeling cute. So you are down for a video chat. Today I really just want to be on my couch in my pizza stained sweats and have an audio date and not worry about what I look like. So I think folks just want to be able to pick and choose their experience on any given day.
Man, that seems like a lot of work.
It is a lot of work.
A lot of work to like be dating and using all these different applications, and
it can be hard. And we are really hoping to make it easier. And we're hoping one of the things that, you know, we're really trying to remind people is it seems like there's more effort involved in going on an audio date, but it's actually almost less because you don't have to worry about messaging 15 people at once and remembering who's who and then coordinating a date with them. Like you literally just put in, I'm free for a date whenever, and you do the magic for me.
Yeah.
So it's a lot easier. And so we're really hoping to bring a little bit more fun into it and take out some of that stress.
Right. What's the what's the back end like as a creator, you know, working on this thing? How do you see this all unfolding? Like you're like the grand wizard and you see like, oh, there's all these dates and going on and stuff.
All these dates. No, we really, you know, I guess that we're really looking forward to launching and getting our initial feedback so we can see how we should expand the app. We have a lot of amazing ideas, but we really want to hear from users. But our dream is to really, you know, start seeing within the first few months, people reaching out and telling us, hey, we found a connection here. And we actually had that on our podcast. We had one of our couples turn into, they're now platonic friends, but they did go on several dates and their relationship has blossomed into a friendship. And I think that's actually another thing worth kind of reminding people. Dating, you know, I think people really think about when they go on a first date, like, is this person the one? Mm. We really think that first question should be, is this someone I want to keep talking to?
Yeah.
And, you know, that reduces some of the pressure and, you know, the other person, it reduces some of the expectations you're putting on yourself and on that other person. And dating is supposed to be an experience. You're not supposed to immediately find your person necessarily. Like it's okay to go out and decide, okay, I don't want to continue with this person, or okay, I want to continue with this person as a friend, or hey, I want to explore this in a romantic sense. So I think, you know, we're really hoping to make it, again, more fun and a little reduce some of that pressure that like it has to be this, it has to mean that you're going to be on the altar. You have this picture of you and the other person at the altar in a month or something.
Well, how do you, I mean, I don't know how old you are, but I'm not going to ask you, but I'm going to say, but I'm in my 40s and I know I have a lot of friends who are like in their 20s, strangely enough. And dating seems like a huge minefield for them. Mm-hmm. They find it extremely difficult with current society's attitudes or maybe the technology behind it. How do you view this? How do you think young people are dating today? And in part two of this question, do you see this, what's the demographic maybe you're shooting for this?
With the second question. So the demographic that we're shooting for are folks who are usually mid to late 20s to their, late 40s. So people who are kind of beyond the, I just want to, hook up and have a great time, which totally valid, be young, have fun.
Yeah.
People who are now kind of transitioning into that, I want to find somebody to spend my life with phase. Mm. And in terms of how people, who might be in their 20s are dating, I think one thing that adds a lot of pressure beyond just the normal societal expectations of, your parents being like, oh, are you seeing someone? When are you giving me grandkids? That sort of stuff that's existed forever is social media. You see other people in relationships, you see snapshots of them traveling, snapshots of their gorgeous, photos dancing or with their pets. And you think you're supposed to have that. But what you don't realize is there's so much more behind that photo. It's a highlight reel. You're not seeing all the hard parts in between, all the work people do, the fights they have. There are all sorts of stories now of TikTok couples who seem perfect, who then get divorced and how people process that. So I think there's just so much pressure to be perfect, so much pressure to fit into this, mold of I have my perfect person who I'm now going to post perfect photos with. And that just, it's creating an unhealthy expectation, I think, all around.
I think so too. I mean, I don't know anyone that's that age that is not frustrated with how these things are going, or they're going on physical dates and either both of them or one of them are just on their phones the whole time.
Oh gosh.
Which is crazy.
It is really a shame. And this actually, so I was thinking about this when you said that you met your partner in 2003 before dating apps were really big and people were meeting others in person then. I think that's a lot harder now because of smartphones. Yeah. When people are now shopping in grocery stores or in the bookstore or wherever they may be, they're staring at their phone. And so the idea of striking up a conversation with a random person that you think is, worth talking to because of the book they're reading or something, it's hard. Like it's really hard, or because the book they have in their bag, obviously they're not phone and book in hand, but it's just a lot harder to meet in real life. And so I think, people are on these apps, and I also have not really met anyone who's like, I love being on these dating apps. Like it's a really hard experience.
Well, it's actually kind of like, and this is for all the, people listening, is I've done so many of these episodes, and Taly and I were talking about this before we went on air, is, almost 400. And honestly, even people who are like doing really well with the internet and stuff, honestly, social media really don't like it. Even the people who are like thriving on it don't like it. And there's this weird relationship we're developing with technology, and that it can be very helpful. But on the other side, it's created this strange beast within us. And it's like, it's not a movie where you go, you go to the grocery store line, you're like you're saying, oh, I read that book. That's a good book. Or, whatever it is. Now it's like, oh, I don't want to interrupt them. They're on their phone, Strange. It's so stupid, actually, I think.
It's such a shame because the technology really can help us connect. I think especially during COVID, we saw it helps people stay connected at a time where we really couldn't meet in person, but it's also keeping us apart in many ways. We're using it as a shield and, hiding behind it. And we're also developing these unhealthy expectations. Like there's so much information now about how bad Instagram and Facebook are for people's mental health. And it's just a shame because it can be a really positive place. I actually met my co-founder on Instagram through a dog mom group, and our relationship is now, we've known each other for 5 years. We're really close friends. And so it can bring people together, but it also can bring people apart.
And you know what? I actually just saw how maybe this was some hearing or, I guess they had stopped doing the Instagram for kids because there's so much backlash about it. And the problem is it puts you in kind of this doom scrolling, this kind of constant stimulation thing. I'm not saying it's all bad, but I'm thinking that there's no, whenever you don't have rules or parameters around something, it creates chaos.
Yeah.
I think for a lot of people, it's creating this mental chaos for that.
It really is.
We created also, something with no rules, basically.
I mean, people are creating their own rules for it.
Bang.
You know, I think you see in a lot of shows now with teenagers and young kids, like there's also this idea of, oh, I have to post something and people need to like it. And if they don't like it, they don't like me. And it becomes this spiral of like, you know, stress. And, you know, they're trying to address things like that with certain features. But at the end of the day, like for kids, it's really hard. It can be really damaging.
Yeah, I think, and you have to be very careful. And the crazy thing is the people who create these things don't want their kids on it. That's right. The nuttier thing. It's like, wait a minute, you want my kids on it, but you don't want your kids on it? What kind of stuff is that?
I guess some folks have different priorities. But
yeah. I would say so. There's a hugely different priority. So how does this relate to Blink and your dating app? What's the privacy aspect to it? How do you combat that and creating the expectations for how you want this to go?
Yeah, so I think in many ways our app offers privacy on a level that others don't, because the photo only happens after, like seeing a photo only comes after you have a conversation with someone. So
yeah.
Imagine going on a normal dating app, people essentially take those photos, they can screenshot it, put it in Google and find out a ton of information about the person yes. they're dating, which can have its benefits. Sometimes you learn things that you know, should know upfront, but other times can be really problematic because, you know, you're essentially sleuthing on someone and it, yeah. your privacy can really be kind of exposed that way yeah. and violated. And so in some ways it's really, you know, you're able to, all you're sharing is your first name before you meet someone. You're not, you know, somebody can't go down the rabbit hole trying to find out information about you. With that said, we also think it's really important that the people who are who they say they are. So we have, you know, basic yeah. phone verification, people put in their phone numbers, and we have the reporting functionality. So if there are any issues, we can resolve them very quickly. But you know, it's dating is, you know, kind of scary. And I think one of the yeah. things we hope to do down the line is partner with some of the companies that offer these, you know, services to make sure, like I said, people are who they say they are and the experience yeah. is safe. So that's something that we're looking forward to doing once we're out of the beta stage.
Well, I also was thinking too, is like, can people put in like fake names and like, so they, you know, I feel like that's where the weirdness of the internet is. It's this anonymous nature of people's lives. And this, yeah. and I think honestly, for me, the internet has changed people's behavior.
Oh, like
people
absolutely.
Are more brazen and more outgoing online, and they're like an altered version of themselves, but the in-person version is usually not as crazy as the online
absolutely.
Person.
Absolutely. You know? Anonymity creates a lot of,
yeah.
gives a lot of boldness. I think, you know, there is that problem in any app and any online forum. In Blink's case in particular, there is friction because people need to put in their availability and show up for a date to actually interact with another human. So there's right. no ability to send nasty messages to someone that you've never met, which happens on traditional dating apps. After people match, they, you know, you see a lot of accounts that are sharing these screenshots and they're really terrible. And wow. so there is friction because in order to actually communicate with someone, you need to put in your availability and you need to join the date at the scheduled time.
Yeah.
So it's a lot harder to, and essentially it's also harder to, you know, be someone that you say you're not. Like, sure, you can yeah. put in a fake name, but you know, if you want to try to catfish someone with somebody else, you need to have somebody else in the room with you during that date pretending yeah. to be you. So it's a lot harder when you're talking about real-time communication as opposed to async communication, which is what most traditional dating apps are using.
Do you think this is what, like, so yours is kind of born out of this kind of difference, all these differences you're speaking about. You think that's where kind of we're headed with dating apps and internet in general is like more privacy, more verification, less hateful things through these technologies?
I want to say that I think it's moving in that direction. I think there are companies that are trying to push it in that direction. I do fear, you know, there are the big companies, like we said, Instagram and Facebook, that have these yeah. opportunities to expose the market to totally different things. Like, it will also depend on the bigger fish in the ocean and what they are choosing to do to protect people. And I don't know that I personally have hope that they will certainly suddenly reverse course and start doing things that are better. But I do think there are a lot of companies that are cropping up that are trying to nudge the Titanic back on course, so to speak.
I like that.
It is a Titanic.
Nudge the Titanic. It is. I mean, it certainly is. I mean, I think we're learning a lot about human behavior, which is curious in the dating aspect of it. I think it has a lot of application to that. Do you feel that there's going to be issues and that are you anticipating issues, like some difficulties with this as it goes along? Just like, hey, there could be some bad actors, or maybe there's going to be some foul play. Is that something you've had discussions about, you talk about?
We certainly have. It's, I think, inevitable. And yes, I don't know of a single community online that has never had bad actors. That's why report functionalities are necessary.
Yep.
And, you know, I think we'll tackle them as we see them. We're not excessively worried at this point. You know, like mm-hmm. I said, for our proof of concept podcast, when we had folks join, we had people that we had no idea who they were. We weren't sure if they would show up. We weren't sure how kind they would be to the people they spoke with. Every single one of them showed up on time. No one ghosted us. Everyone was super respectful. So again, I think there's a self-selection component in what we're doing. And so that isn't to say we'll never have problems. We certainly are ready for them and aware of it. But we're not you know, anticipating that it will be the norm.
Tell me a little bit about if other parameters that may be on there, because I feel like this is something that people want to hear. Is they may have a disdain for the current version of social media and all this stuff, but I still think people want to be online. They want to have this experience. How is that? What are some other parameters you have on Blink that's going to make it differentiate it from other dating apps and just general online experience?
I mean, I think it's really lovely, again, that you don't have to worry about what you look like. So there's this removal of stress because you can just get on your call and move on. I think, again, we're not, one of the things about certain dating apps and, you know, even thinking about video dating, if you don't match afterwards, there can be this feeling of rejection, like you were the person who has been rejected if you said yes to the other person. Whereas in our dating app, you don't actually know if you didn't match with the person because of yourself or the other person, because you might've said no to their photo. And so we are trying to just remove some of those psychological barriers to connecting with people and help make it less of a negative experience, which again, is just very prevalent throughout the internet.
How do I want to go back to the scheduling part, because I think that's really unique. Yeah. I think it's actually incredibly unique. How do you actually schedule the people on it? Like, how do you decide who gets scheduled with who?
Yeah, so we will be, you know, in the initial stages, be offering scheduling limited time slots so that we can funnel people into the same availability slot. So, you know, you aren't finding yourself without dates. And so folks will say, let's say, for example, I'm available Monday, 7 to 9. And we will look to see who else we have, just based on the super basic parameters of age, sexuality, location, you know, those very basic things to match you with a person. And so we're not offering some of the filters that other dating apps have in terms of race or height or things like that. Yeah. We don't believe in those sorts of limitations, which might mean that it's not for everyone, but we do think again, that there are people who that just doesn't matter to them. And they're really looking for their other person, for their other half. I don't actually believe in other halves, but their person. And so, you know, we're not doing any fancy algorithm. We're not filtering people based on, you know, what other people who are like you have liked. We're really just saying, if you're available in the same time slot and you have an overlap of your sexuality, age, and location, you might, you know, be compatible with one another. So have a 10-minute conversation and find out.
How dare you make it that simple?
It's just very simple. It really is.
How could you? I'm like, wait, that's way too simple. I mean, it's like, hey, you got time? I got time, you know, but that's kind of like, that's how I meet people. And I meet a ton of people all the time.
Yeah.
And it's really just, do we have the time? And do they somewhat resonate with me on some level? But a lot of people, I have no clue who they are. Like,
right.
When Stephanie Gordon said, oh, meet, you know, Taly, it's not like I know a lot about you. You know? It's like, okay, let's have a conversation, and we chat and we decide we're both not weirdos.
That's basically, so we're bringing that into dating.
Yeah. But see, this is what I think, like in general, dating obviously is what it's about, but you could take that same approach to just friendship and meeting people. It's like, you don't always have to know everything ahead of time, you know?
Yeah. We have dreams of expanding to other spaces, but we won't get ahead of ourselves.
Yeah, let's not put the whole thing before. But really, it's behavior, and you can take this across many different things. Okay, let's take it to podcasting, right? So like mm-hmm. some guests really want to have all the questions ahead of time because they want to feel like, I want to be prepared. I want to know what you're going to tell me, right? And that's kind of like the whole dating thing is like now people like expect to have all of the information, but you know, like it's never really functioned well that way in the past, right? I mean,
there's so many memes of like, you know, folks going on dates and somebody saying something and the other person thinking, oh, I already knew that because I've Googled you and I know all about your family. I know how many cousins you have. I know about your pets. And yeah. So, you know, it takes out some of the mystery and some of the fun. And again, there's a component of safety that's really important. You don't want to go out with people like, you know, totally out of the blue. But one of the things about having a conversation with someone is, like you said, in that conversation, you get to decide pretty quickly, like, oh, this person is not somebody I want to connect with, or, hey, we're both normal. Let's continue this conversation. Yeah.
I actually find that you know very quickly.
Yeah.
Like it's like really, I don't know what the research says about how quickly, maybe you know this, how quickly people kind of feel it. Is that a thing? I don't even know.
So I don't know about the part. Like, so in about 4 minutes, people have decided whether or not they want to continue talking to someone.
4 minutes?
Whether or not it's, you know, romantic or otherwise, you know, I don't know if it varies based on that, but 4 minutes is the, you know, scientific number.
Okay, people, everyone out there listening, 4 minutes, you have 4 minutes to make a really good impression and don't make it your fake self. It's got to be real you. Okay. Like,
I was just joking about like, should job interviews be 4 minutes? And no, they shouldn't be, but it's like, just no. This like interesting because, you know, you need to demonstrate skills, but 4 minutes, it's a very short amount of time.
So that's, I mean, I didn't know that, but it's kind of what I thought is that you kind of get the sense pretty quickly. Especially when you meet somebody, even like with the video chatting stuff, we're doing it. I get asked all the time, like, do you really like every single podcast episode? I'm like, honestly, everybody's really nice, but you can tell very quickly if somebody's like really nervous.
Yeah.
Or, you know, they're not used to talking to people regularly, but they're trying to push something they're doing.
Right.
And you know, like, I know within like a minute, I'm like, well, this is going to be some heavy lifting here today, man.
I hope you don't feel that today.
I didn't say that.
I feel like I had to say it.
You had to put that out there. So so everybody listening, like we talked ahead of time. So I already knew, but most of the people I don't do that with. So I like not knowing. I'm pretty comfortable not knowing. Because I think I look at it as a challenge to not know a lot about people and then discover who they are for that.
Well,
and that
sounds
like what you're doing.
Having listened to your podcast, you're very good at it. Have not met those folks before, you are very good at kind of having those conversations, drawing out their stories. But yes, to go back to what you were saying, we want to give people that chance to get to know folks for who they are, not just what they look like.
Yeah. Do you find the people you talk to about this, are they excited for this version of a dating app?
They are. So let me caveat it. There are folks who are younger and in that stage where they just want to hook up. So for them, this might not resonate.
Yeah. But
the folks that we're talking to who are in this, our target market and the demographic that we're looking at, the late 20s to 40s, they are really interested in this. They are tired of dating apps that, you know, make them feel like a commodity and make them spend so much time getting to a date only to realize within 4 minutes of starting the date that they're not interested in proceeding. And so, you know, it's been really great to talk to people and have that validated. And I'm so excited to actually put it in people's hands and see what they say.
You know, what's weird for this for me is like, you got me all pumped up about this and I'm someone who could never use this, but I'm like, how do I know? Like, I got
you'll have to tell all your friends.
I know. I actually do have a lot of single friends. I'm like one of the only people who's been in a relationship for like almost 20 years. And literally all of my really good friends are single. And they're all like either 50 or 20 something. It's so weird. But
well, they can try the app and tell us. Yeah.
Is the app free? Is it free or does it cost money?
It will be free, totally free. Eventually we'll offer a freemium model with some freemium features, but that is not anytime in the foreseeable near future.
I wonder about that. I developing something myself, not on dating, clearly. Some other social networking thing I'm working on, but Why do most companies not charge? I mean, maybe I don't even know that I'm saying this correctly. Do most people not charge the dating apps for this?
Well, I think almost all of them have a free tier and okay. then offer premium features. And I think from my perspective, you know, first off, one of our founding core tenets is like equality. And so we would never want to make our app something that isn't accessible to everyone. That would really just make us sad. Yeah. And I think the other perspective is like, you know, it's really hard to sell someone on something they haven't experienced. And so the idea of making someone pay just to sign up, it adds a layer of friction that, you know, might prevent you from getting users. And a dating app is also a marketplace. You need to have all sides of the equation. You need men, women, you need people who are heterosexual, homosexual, and everywhere in between on that spectrum. And so in order to really build that place where you have that combination of interests and overlap, you need as many people as possible. And so making it free is a way to incentivize folks to try it out.
You know, it makes a lot of sense with dating, especially mm-hmm. because you're trying to capture pretty much the largest pool of people as possible. I always wonder about it on the sense like the internet in general, like social media is always free. But sometimes I don't like that aspect of it. Mm-hmm. And, you know, this sounds crazy. I'm like asking to pay for something. But I think when you pay for something, sometimes you pay a different attention to it.
Right.
You know, like,
I think that's true.
I think I really do. And I think in some instances, I think paying should be how things, I'm not saying for this. This is just a discussion generally about the internet and social media. Dating makes sense to me because you're trying to capture a large pool. But sometimes I think when you'd have no monetary investment in something, your behavior is somewhat flippant sometimes with it because you just don't care. You know, like, well,
you don't have the same skin in the game, right?
Yeah. You have no skin in the game. And when you pay for something, you pay attention a little differently. How you pay attention is up for debate, but I think you pay it, it's different when you do mm-hmm. that.
I totally agree. And I think now that you say that, it's coming to mind. I think there is one dating app or web-based that is primarily like you have to pay. And I think some people gravitate towards that because they think if somebody else is paying to be here, they're going to be intentional about it. And I want to be with other people who are intentional about dating. And so I think you're totally right in dating and beyond. Like if it's free, you're not necessarily feeling the same level of commitment and investment. Yeah. Whereas if it's not, you're like, it's sort of like going to a gym. If I put, you know, $100 into a membership, I feel like I should go. And so I think it's definitely an incentivization to take it more seriously. I do think we have that with Blink and the time commitment people are putting in.
Yeah.
You know, you're not going to sign up if you're not willing to actually go on a 10-minute date. And so again, there's a self-selection component of people who are more serious, but your time is not the same as money. They're both different forms of investment. Right. But I think you're onto something.
I think so. I've been thinking about this, like as I'm developing different things, I think about what I don't like about social media. And I'm like, well, you know, there becomes this other beast of like investors, advertisement, algorithms and stuff. Like, well, what if there was an initial payment? Anyways, I'm going on too much about that. I would just think about it. But like, I paid for Match.com. I paid for that. Mm-hmm. I remember it was like $23 or something like that a month. I remember because this was like a long, long time ago. My mom convinced me to do it. Okay, everyone, my mom convinced me to do it. And I said, you know what I said? I said, that's for losers. That's what I told her. And she goes, no, a friend of mine got married. I'm like, how is that possible? I was telling her that. I was so wrong. I was definitely wrong.
And now here you are married.
I know. And for a long time, and it's been awesome. It's been amazing. But I do remember paying for it. And that was like, that was interesting. Now I see that it's mostly free. So tell me a little about the premium stuff you mentioned. What is that? You don't have to say for your own thing, but what is what has been what you've seen for premium payment stuff and other stuff that may be relevant?
Yeah, I think you see a lot of the ability to filter based on certain parameters, which we might offer down the line for the lifestyle choices. So like I said, definitely never having filters based on appearances or height or things like that. But to the extent somebody is interested in having a family, that is super important. And you might not want to spend time talking to someone who isn't interested in having a family. And so filters like that, that isn't to say we would only offer those specific things for money, but just saying filters are one category of things that are freemium feature. Other ones include, I think, on traditional dating apps, like the number of swipes that you can get or being able to see who said yes to you first and things like that. That wouldn't necessarily apply in our context. And we would still, we have to explore kind of, again, what people want based on the beta feedback when we decide what we're going to develop next and offer either free or as a premium feature. So I can't speak necessarily to what our premium features will be.
Sure.
But I think those are kind of a lot of what you see in the dating context, you know.
Yeah.
Enhanced filters, being able to see who's liked you first, and more swipes, more matches.
This is incredible stuff, honestly. I'm like, there's so much science to dating on some level for that. But you're saying, like, this is like so simple, what you're proposing. It's almost too simple.
There's so much science to it. It's almost too simple. There's a lot of science around it, but I think what the science is showing us is that there is no science to it. So you can't, you know, predict who's going to be successful and who isn't based on the things that people might think are, you know, make it predictable, like demographics, if you have overlap of interest, like it's actually fairly unpredictable. Huh. And so it, that's kind of, science shows there's no science. It seems like a weird way to put it, but it's been really interesting to kind of see, you know, what the research has been. And again, like I said earlier, attraction, which is what people are like, oh, I'm so excited about this person. That initial attraction, that initial spark doesn't usually translate into, it doesn't have any connection or correlation to whether or not the relationship will become a long-term one. And so it's just, you know, one of the things we think is great about Blink then is you're kind of removing that whole layer of all of that, of saying like, oh, I only want somebody who's this, or I think I need somebody who has this educational background.
Yeah.
You're now able to connect with anyone and, you know, remove a lot of the stigma around that.
It's so funny. It's much like anything. People put walls up about things initially, and dating is no different than any other aspect where you say, hey, I need these things to happen in order for me to participate in this, which is a shame because you often miss out on really amazing things when you create all these barriers to entry to something.
That just makes me think, I took my dad once to a cooking class without telling him beforehand, and he was miserable for the first 15 minutes. He's like, why can't I just go to a restaurant and eat the food? And by the end of it, you could see he's like really getting into it. And so, you know, like you said, people put up these barriers and these walls, and it keeps them from having experiences that otherwise could be really fun. And, you know, ones they would enjoy if they just gave it a shot.
Yeah. And it seems like attraction, when you talk about physical attraction, that is often a barrier for people. Like a huge barrier, but they, people have a hard time letting go of that. Is that something that you have seen with people, that they just struggle with letting go of the physical attraction part?
I think it's definitely something that's super prevalent for a lot of people. I think some people are absolutely ready to let go of it. You know, so our first podcast episode, our first couple, they actually totally unprompted by us, started talking about how people are too focused on looks and how they, you know, want to get to know people for who they are, which was really beautiful to listen to. I think though, something I want to point out is that I think the looks thing actually helps, actually blinds us to negative things sometimes too. So psychologist Ken Page. So if you're really attracted to someone, you're going to ignore red flags. Because you're going to make excuses for them. You're going to, you know, think like, oh, but I'm really into them, or, oh, they could be this other person that I expect them to be. And it creates like a kind of a toxic relationship potentially. And so looks, it could be a double-edged sword, you know, it could attract you to someone who isn't good for you. And so I think, again, putting that compatibility first helps you focus on what really matters in a long-term relationship.
This just popped into my mind.
No.
It's part of the craziness of my show. I'm like, what? And why did this pop in my mind? Do you feel like some people use their looks as, I don't want to say a weapon, but as, it's like their main thing. It's what they use to, it's what they're used to using to create a relationship.
Yeah.
How does that affect somebody when that is all they know how to create a relationship? And then you say, well, just listen to my voice, you know.
Have you watched Too Hot to Handle on Netflix?
I haven't.
It, in a nutshell, takes a bunch of people who are really attractive and used to being kind of told that they're attractive, puts them on an island together and says, you're not allowed to have any physical relationship with anyone. Like, you can develop emotional connections. Yeah. We want you to do that, but you can't kiss, you can't touch, you can't do these other things. And it's really interesting to see these people who have relied on their looks to make connections for their entire lives realize, like, oh no, now I have to talk to this person. I have to get to know them. I have to be vulnerable myself.
Yeah.
And see kind of how they cope with that. For some people, it doesn't necessarily land. They are like, no, I'm cool with what I was doing before. And for other people, it's like, oh my God, there's this whole world of connection that I've been missing out on because I was just into the superficialness of connections before. And so I think I sort of think that's like a microcosm, and that's sort of what we would see here.
Yeah.
For folks who, you know, might have been matching on dating apps solely based on being really conventionally attractive, they might have a totally different experience once they actually start talking to people and start trying to really connect with them.
You think it'll be awkward for people who have grown up in just in this age, and they're just like, I don't know how to talk to people. You know how many young people don't know how to talk to people? Like, a lot. It's like a lot. You know that, Taly?
No, I have noticed that, and sometimes I'm like, is it me? Am I the problem?
No. You're not the problem.
I'm not the problem. I think, you know, I don't know that our dating app necessarily will attract some of those younger folks, like the Gen Z. Like, they're potentially a little too young to be blurred into blank. I think the millennial generation is what we're looking at, and they're a little bit better at conversational skills.
Like, slightly.
Not all of them. But I think, it will challenge them. I think, you know, for folks who are used to swiping and communicating through tweets and through, you know, comments on images, like, it will be different. But at the end of the day, you know, you're not going to build a life with someone based on tweets. Like, I don't know, maybe that's how Gen Z is going to do it. But at the end of the day, they're going to need to find somebody who they can connect with. If they want, obviously, if they want to fly solo, that's cool too. A life on tweets. Just tweet back and forth in different rooms.
Maybe somebody's done that. They built a life on tweets.
Maybe. I know Snap is really big too. They just snap back and forth, and that's how, you know, people communicate throughout the day. And I could never get into that.
I don't get that.
Little pictures, snapshots.
This is like an alien world to me, man. It's like, I'm all about like talking to people. You know, it's like it's like really like, that's why I think when I started a podcast, I was like, it's no big deal. I'm just talking to people, but I'm used to that. I'm used to not having a cell phone, as hard as it is to believe. Anybody listen, a lot of my audience, I have a good chunk of my audience is like 25 years old to 30. There was a time before cell phones, there was brick phones. I didn't have the brick phone, but I'm telling you, you had to talk to people, man.
I've been with my partner now 11 years. And when we first started dating, he had a brick phone and he never took it anywhere. And so I think he started taking it with him because I would send him messages. I'm a little younger than he is. He was like, well, I wanted to reply to you, so I guess I had to bring my phone with me. And so that's how he broke into, I guess, the phone technology, the being glued to your phone world.
And so this is an app. This is primarily just for your phone, right? Blink is...
Yes, but we do hope to offer virtual and in-person events once it's safe, in-person events down the line.
I see. So you're going to add not only the virtual, but like, hey, let's take this to physical. Like, how do you envision that going, actually?
Yeah, sort of like Love is Blind, but for the masses, and blackout crazy. Pods. So not, you can't see anything. You can't see the hand in front of your face when you're having your conversation with someone. It really changes. It's sort of like when you think about Daredevil, how, you know, he can't see, so that's his other senses are amplified. So sort of like that, it's putting you in this kind of space where you can really listen and focus on your other senses other than just sight. And so blackout pods.
You're going to have to take people's phones. You know this, right? Before they go.
I told you it was born at a blackout restaurant. They took your phones. They took your watches. They took all of your technology. So definitely.
Might be some people crying in there. I can't have my phone.
For a couple of hours. You can unplug a little. They're going to have withdrawal by the end of it.
I mean, it can be an addictive thing, you know, for a lot of people. I mean, their existence is completely on a phone. You know,
yep.
I don't know. I think dating just fascinating to me for someone who is not doing it, can't do it. It's like, I just wonder, I'm curious about human behavior and how people connect with each other. Yeah. And dating is one of the craziest, strangest ways people connect with each other. It's like this weird dance.
It really is.
Yeah,
it's changed. It's changed over time.
Like, well, how is it going to keep changing? That's the thing.
You know, I wish, I'm really hopeful that it'll change towards the better and the direction that we're hoping for and become less superficial and that people can kind of focus on the important stuff. It's interesting. If you look, you know, at folks from who met in the 50s, they met based on where they lived. They primarily were marrying people who lived in their same buildings or blocks or neighborhoods. And they stayed together for a really long time because they weren't looking for passion. They were looking for companionship and somebody to build a family with. So I think what people are looking for is changing. How they're looking for it is changing. And I'm hopeful that people are kind of recalibrating into this space of, I don't want just, you know, piece of arm candy, but I want somebody to navigate life with.
Man, that would be nice. I mean, a more inclusive, man, the 50s thing sounds weird to me.
It is a little weird.
Honestly, it sounds a little weird. It was like, I'm not really that into you, but I kind of am. I don't know.
It's like companionship. It's like they became friends. It sounds like more than, you know, and you know, I don't know. I'm a big fan of Esther Perel, and she talks a lot about how, you know, that used to be all you were looking for, somebody to live your life with. Somebody, one person would bring home, you know, the bacon, so to speak, and the other person kept the home. And now people are expecting a best friend, a lover. They're expecting passion, you know, security. And some of these things aren't compatible. Like, you know, passion is sometimes born of mystery, and mystery is the counter of security. And so we're creating this environment where it's actually really hard to find somebody who's checking off all the boxes, at least in a long-term capacity.
But how can you be all those things to one person?
You can't. It takes a village, and I think now people are expecting it in one person, and it's maybe that's why, you know, there are more separations now than there were in the 50s. But it's definitely interesting to think about.
Well, I tell you what, this has been awesome. I mean, it's really, hopefully it's been an interesting time for you.
It's been so much fun.
I just riff on all this stuff. I just think it's so fascinating. So I'm really glad. Shout out to Stephanie Gordon for connecting me to Taly. This is awesome. Blink, I want you to just sign off about it. Tell everyone how they can get involved with it. When's it coming out? The whole deal, how they can find it.
Yeah. So if you're interested in checking out Blink, we have our waitlist open now. It's at our website, www.theblinkdate.com. If in the meantime, you want to check out what the experience is like, you can listen to our podcast, Date in a Blink. We're actually recruiting for our season 2 this month. So if you want to try it out and be on a podcast yourself and go on a date with someone, sign up. If you just ever want to reach out and talk to us about dating, your experiences, or anything like that, you can find us on social at The Blank Date on Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, TikTok, and beyond.
TikTok and beyond. There we go. TikTok
and beyond. There's so many platforms.
Yeah.
I just went into beyond.
Yeah. Now you're adding to the pantheon of things.
I know.
More choices.
Don't do so. No, I'm kidding.
Yeah.
I really am.
Well, thank you so much. Literally, you're wonderful to talk to, Taly. Really, you're so thank easy you. To talk to. He's very
it was easy. Really my pleasure.
Yeah, for sure. And thank you for being on, and we will be in touch.
Awesome. Sounds great.